Well, I guess it's time for the Recovery Connection. Now, I this is Pastor Bruce Wall. I'm normally sitting in my house at this time, and these two gifted women of God come on the air, and I sit and I listen to both of you. So welcome to your broadcast, and I can't wait until one of you is sitting over here introducing your own broadcast, Recovery Connection.
Thank you, Pastor Wall.
Thank you for sitting there for Brother Mark. And this is Sister Benicia. How everybody doing? And to my right is Sister Leslie.
Hey.
And our topic will be...
Go on.
Posing at the Podium. It seemed like I couldn't wait to get that out. It's called... The topic will be called Posing at the Podium. And basically, one evening last week, me and Leslie was on the phone, and we was talking about a lot of stuff that we have witnessed through our many years of being in recovery. And doing this recovery walk and what it takes and where you gotta go to get your tools and certain places where you had to go to get your tools to continue this walk in recovery. You have to go to meetings, and you know, for me, I used to see a lot of things at the meetings, and it used to like really like floor me, because I was like, how come they're up here saying all this, but then when you go outside, it's a whole different story. They're doing this and they're doing that. Mm-hmm. And I know when I used to go back to back to the house, because they was allowing us to go to the meetings while we were in treatment, if you was allowed a phase 2 or 3. And you know, and my counselors used to always say, it's not about the messenger, it's about the message. You know, don't look at the messenger. You remember what the message is, because that message can help save your life. Now that I'm doing this Christian walk, I feel a familiarity in the same place again. And I'm trying, it's starting to connect. And you know, and I'm doing my best and remembering what my counselor used to say, don't look at the messenger, just look at the message, you know. And for me, it takes, I have to sometimes just sit and just pray while I'm in service or wherever I'm at, you know, where I'm supposed to be at a place of fellowshipping and, you know, and just, you know, just being in the, you know, glory of God. You know, there's times where, you know, for me, I have to, for me to just pray. You know, just go pray. Whatever is ungodly is in here, pray it out, Lord, take it out, or whatever. Because for me, with my negative side, because he's still working on Venetia, you know, I will easily feed into the negativity. And that's what Satan wants. He does what he wants you, and he serves right up in that church just like anybody else. And Leslie?
I was trying to read my own writing. What I can say about that, I remember being in early recovering and being told, you know, to go to meetings, connect with folks in the fellowship so that I would have a support system, because my friends were still using. And I remember going to meetings and hearing, it appeared to be mostly men, but to hear some of the men speak, and I'd be like, oh my God, I'd be so enthralled on what they were saying. And you know, they were like at a fever pitch, and they were like preachers standing up there at the podium. And I had never experienced anything like that. And I was listening to the message, and I was just amazed at what they had gone through, and now they were
exactly
clean.
Yes.
And you know, God's got jokes. He let me see that. You know, I even had the courage to speak to a couple of people and just tell them, you know, I really felt their message, and you know, and I was going to keep coming back, and you know, because that was the phrase back then, keep coming back. And outside the meeting, they'd be selling clothes.
drugs,
talking to women, you know, hanging outside, you know, instead of, you know, being, some of them, instead of being in the meeting, they're outside having their own meeting. And I'm like, what is this? And then as I started to, I did not know at that time that my discernment was kicking in, I would just zero in on things and say, oh my God, you know, I'd see people relapsing actively, you know, whoring actively, and victimizing women.
Yes.
And I was just like, oh no. And you know, I had a very hard time because a couple of the gentlemen, I really thought, you know, they were so on point. And you know, my sponsor was like, you need to listen and you need to watch. And one of the things that she told me was to sit up front. Because I was so bashful and I didn't know anybody, I sat in the back, and that's how I saw all of that mess. And I slowly started moving up to the front, and then it got to the point I had to sit in the front. I couldn't sit in the back because I just saw too much, I felt too much, and I knew that my life literally was at stake because I would have been caught up in all that negativity and all that womanizing. And, you know, I wasn't all that healthy at that point. I still wanted to be needed and appreciated, you know, and that would have been it for me. And at one point, I had to change fellowships to get a more secure base and not to have all of that stuff around me. And I'm so grateful that I did that. Because I was weak, you know, and sometimes I see the same thing. I hate to say it, but I see the same thing in the church. People that are new and coming in are hurting. They're the ones that get abused. Mm-hmm. Folks say stuff, folks, their body language, and you can't do that. You can't act like you got it going on, and then if somebody walks in the door that isn't there yet, you can't snub them. You know, or shun them because you hurt people's feelings. You know, and we've said it on just about almost every broadcast, it seems like, hurt people hurt people.
And my thing, and I don't want to cut you off, but you can go right back to it. But then, and I don't know, maybe in the book of Matthew, I'm still learning my scriptures, you know. Didn't Jesus say that I didn't come here for the righteous?
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? He's come for those that are sinning. You know what I mean? So who are we to judge? Mm-hmm. Who are we to be judging others as walking for hope and looking for salvation, looking probably for the same thing that we all walk through that door looking for? Mm-hmm. We have no rights to be doing that. Mm-hmm. And it's in God's living word. I'm sorry, Leslie. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It's
because that is real powerful what you just said, because it happens a lot. I know. I'm sorry.
It's when people are in the spotlight, they look good, they sound good, but you need to watch when they're away from that podium, when they're away from the crowd, when they're away from them, their spotlight, to see how they're really living. Mm-hmm. Are they just saying stuff, or, you know, as Jordan says, are they doing it? Just do it. You know, you can't be, I know it's in the scripture, and Pastor Wall can help with that, you can't be double-minded. You can't serve two masters. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're either going to do what you need to do so that you can get a handle and try to conquer your addiction, or you're going to follow God's word when you're in worship and treat people the way Jesus would. You know, that you're going to be loving, you're going to be kind, you're going to be patient, and you're going to be available. And you're not going to shun somebody because they don't quite fit in at that moment. You know, and it's real important. I mean, I personally believe we need to have, like, welcome meetings to let people know that they're a part of, they're welcome no matter where they come from.
Yeah.
That, you know, and that takes a special type of person. And yes. I'm not saying that we're it.
No.
But we've both been at worship services where nobody even came up to us and said hello.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, so it's real important that if you see somebody new, either in your worship or in your recovery arena, that you let them know you see them. Because that's all they're looking for in both cases is a home, a place to call home, a place to feel safe, a place to feel like they fit in. And, you know, everything will work out. You know, we all come in rough around the edges, you know, and through time and people just loving on us and God's love, we change. We become the person that we want to be. I remember saying, I don't want to be like that. You know, seeing people work a regular 9 to 5. I'm just coming in the house, getting ready to crash. But, you know, at some point, that was me. Mm-hmm. I was employable. I went to work. I was dependable, you know. But when I was, caught up in that lifestyle, you know, I thought that was like square. Oh, you know, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be like that. When reality, I think I really did. I just didn't know it, and I didn't think I could. Mm-hmm. So I didn't put that out there, mm-hmm. you know, because I always got told I couldn't do something. Right, you know, exactly. You're not good enough to do that. You're too stupid to do that. Mm-hmm. You're not pretty enough to do that. So my expectations,
girls don't do that.
My expectations of myself were very low. And, you know, thank God for recovery that I had people that loved me in spite of me, you know, and I couldn't shake them off. I could mean mug them all day long and they wasn't going nowhere. You know, and they would call me on my stuff, mm-hmm. you know, and just all they said was, give it back. That's all we want you to do is give it back.
Yep, that's the only way you can keep it. You have to give it back. And for me, after we had that discussion about a couple of days later, something I don't know. Only thing I could say is the Holy Spirit started speaking, you know, and it's, you know, and like, and Leslie will tell you, I get all excited when I see the manifestation of God and after his works, and, you know, I just get so drunk in what he's doing, and I just go crazy, you know, and I heard him say, you know, when you act like that sometimes, people think that I only speak to you and you alone. And when I heard that, it, like, just took me aback because, for me, it's just like, oh, my God, the God is really here, you know, Jesus said, you know. But other people may look at it in a totally different light. Mm-hmm. I may be coming from that. I'm just trying to be posing at the podium. Mm-hmm. You understand what I mean? He had me take a look at me, mm-hmm. and make sure that I wasn't in it, and it was all about him and nothing about me, mm-hmm. you know. And that's where he got me right now, you know. So right now is like, Lord, in the name of your Son and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, decrease in me, my God. Remove every bit of me out of the way so you can increase more in me and it can be all about you.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus. Wow. God's a good God. That's all I got to say. You know, he'll come at you and you got it. Like, you know, Brother Mark said, you know, you got that relationship and you're willing to listen and you'll be open to hear what he say. He'll teach you. He will guide you, you know, but you got to get out your own way. You got to get out your own way.
Yeah, if you don't get out your way, God will push you out the way.
He'll knock that door. He'll
just say, it ain't about you, it's That's about right. me. And, you know, you're hurting my people.
Yes.
So, you know, he's not going to allow that. And then that kind of leads into the other part that I've got down here that, you know, folks can be so worshipful in church, and they're looking the part of a saint, and all they're really doing is following the religious traditions of the church and of church folks. They've got on that church mantle, and then when they're not around anyone, it's a totally different person. They don't practice everything that they proclaim to be, and that's all right, because everybody goes through a process, but don't be a phony about it. You know, if there's issues that you still got, let people know so people won't think that, you know, this walk calls for you to be perfect, because it doesn't. We are imperfect people who are following a perfect Christ. So he expects us that we're going to mess up, mm-hmm. you know, and he's just going to keep saying, okay, you know, dust yourself off and let's do this again.
Mm-hmm.
And I know for me, one of the things that he's been placing in my spirit lately is that I need to let people know how he's blessing us, me, mm-hmm. my family, my friends, you know, to stay humble mm-hmm. in nature and spirit. And I don't see a lot of that. Mm-hmm. You know, I keep my mouth shut. You know, God is like, bridle your tongue, tame that temper. Yep. You know, don't be judgmental. Yep. Just, you see it, keep it to yourself.
Yep.
I'll pray handle it.
Pray on it. Pray on it. Pray it away.
You know, and I guess the last part that he was like really like hammering home, we should be shouting about what God is doing for us, but we shouldn't be flaunting it.
Girl, I'm about to get up and run. I'm about to get up and run. I'm scared. Jesus. Woo. My God.
We should always display an attitude of gratitude that we are just so thankful for everything mm-hmm. that God is doing in, through, and around us.
Amen.
And we are going to take a quick break. Again, you're listening to The Recovery Connection, Saving Our Souls.
At Boston Praise Radio.
For me, and I can say, never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I can see that you were the one I held on to. And I never
would have made it.
Oh, I never could have made it.
Never could have made it now.
Hey, I would have lost it all. Oh, but now I see how you were there for me. I never
would have made
it. No, I never
could have made it without you.
I would have lost my mind a long time ago if it had not been for you.
We want to welcome you back to the Recovery Connection, Saving Our Souls. I'm Miss Leslie, and sitting with me is Miss Venetia.
Hey, y'all. Welcome back. So, finish talking about the run around the podium,
Okay. Our topic for today is posing at the podium. And basically, we're talking about how folks that are in recovery can stand up at a meeting and just sound fabulous. They sound like, was it Les Brown? He's Gladys Knight's helper. Yeah. They motivate you, and they've set you on fire, and they've set the meeting on fire. And then if you watch them when they're not in that spotlight, you know, they're still doing some of the slimy, low-life things that they were doing before they came into the halls. And that's a disservice mm-hmm. because you're not letting people know that it can get better. That, you know, you've changed. You know, you're striving to be different. You're striving to be better. And you're perpetuating a bondage.
And not only that, it's a disservice for those that's coming up and coming through the doors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're supposed to be our...
An example.
An example, our mentors. You know, okay, that's why they say you got to get you... Girl, you know, it's been a minute. I ain't been in the hall. Oh, Lord help me. Jesus. Well, you have to get someone to walk you through, and they don't want you to have a male. If
yeah,
you're a woman.
Women sponsor women, men sponsor men.
You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, people got issues, mm-hmm. you know? And we're not saying that you got to be perfect. We're not saying any of that. We're saying stop, you know, perpetrating. Stop being a phony. You know, if you, this is who you are, and this is what you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. You know, at least like talk about it and get through so you can get some help, because when you get help, you helping the next person that's coming up in behind you, you know, or the person that's in front of you. We are supposed to be helping each other. I spoke to a sister this week, and I know she know who I'm talking about, and she was missing her mommy so bad, and I could relate to what she was feeling, you know, and I just could not let her go. You know, I couldn't let it go. I kept inboxing her and sending her messages, you know, on Facebook. And, you know, and I said to her, I said, listen, we are spiritual encouragers to one another. Because she had thanked me. I said, don't thank me. You know, we thank God for allowing us to be spiritual encouragers because that's what he made us for, to encourage each other when we are down and when we're going through the good stuff. We're supposed to, you know, just support one another wholeheartedly. And I truly believe that, not just walking in recovery, you know, but also especially walking through Christianity. And like Leslie said, no, God don't expect us to be perfect, but he has given us the tools called the book of the Bible, the book of life, you know. Am I perfect? By far, no. There's so much work that he's continuously doing on me, but I can really say I'm grateful, I'm humble, and I receive it because I know that it's going to help me be a better person for him. Not for me, but for him. And when I become a better person for the Lord, that means I'm a better person for the people in my family. That means for the people, whoever that I have assignments that he has assignments out there for. You know, I'm going to be the light of the Lord, not the light of Venetia. And I can't stress that enough. You know, like Leslie said something a little while ago about flaunting. You know, I ain't going to lie. I used to flaunt. I used to love flying.
I was in the gold club.
You know,
Mrs. T.
I was a singer. You know what I mean? You couldn't tell me nothing. You know, I get. You know what I mean? I'm on the stage. You know, I had that personality, and it was all about me. And all, you know what I mean? And then when I really started singing and feeling the words in that choir, it became all about him. And I didn't care how I looked. I didn't care if my mouth was crooked if I was singing. I didn't care if I was drooling or my clothes was falling off of me. Because I was singing for the Lord and hoping, praying that I was reaching to the highest balcony and that a soul that I was singing, trying to reach out to, was being touched. It was no longer about the image of Venetia and being vain and all that, even though I did get kind of vain when Pastor Wall said he was going to put us on the air.
Okay, I'll take that one back. I didn't tell you still working on it.
You know, but, you know, it's just the work that he wants us to do. And, you know, we just need to be willing to do it and just love on each other, you know. I think this is, I was trying to find a scripture, and usually he just drops it right on me. But so I guess this is the one, and it's going to come from Hebrews. And it is chapter 10, verse 24. Let us consider how we may spur another on toward love and good deeds. And I think this is basically what we're talking about. Stop being a phony. And if that's who you are, so what? Be transparent. We learn from each other's transparency. And it's okay because you're teaching. We're teaching models, you know? And I mean, it's up to us, you know, whether we're going to receive the gifts that you're trying to teach us with, that God's given us by allowing us to see it. That's all I'm saying.
And you're not only teaching, you're helping. Because that way folks will know that they can have missteps, that they don't have to try to get this right.
Oh,
you know,
my God.
Because if you got that addictive personality, you're going to try your darndest to get it right. Walk right, talk right, look right.
Yeah.
And you put more work into it than what's really necessary.
Yeah, it's just
It is so simple, but as humans, we just complicate everything, you know. And they tell you when you first come into recovery, 90 meetings, 90 days, stay, you know, stay with the people that you want to be like, stay with the people who you know are doing the right thing, get a sponsor, you know, get a therapist, you know, whatever it is that you need to do to get through and to start to come out on the other side. And that gives you hope, you know. You know, like I said, when I heard those folks and they sounded great, And then I had that letdown. That was like, oh man, if they're messed up like this, what's going to happen to me? You know, because I didn't have that experience. You know, they were supposed to be sharing their strength. And it was only part time. You know, their strength was when they were being looked at. But when they weren't, they were in the, like in dark shadows, just living that life. And I'm so grateful that God surrounded me with people that could let me see that or point that out to me and keep me from floundering. Mm-hmm. Because if I had been left to my own devices, I would have. Mm-hmm. You know, God will put people in your life to help you, to walk you through whatever season that you're going through. And you just have to be available and you just need to be ready and you have to, you know, keep it simple. You know, don't act like you know it all because you don't. Mm-hmm. You know, learn from people that have been there before you and take what fits. Take what works for you. You know, this is not a one size fits all. You know, you tailor make this thing to you. And it's the same thing with your Christian walk. Mm-hmm. Follow Jesus, read your Bible, stay in the Word. And develop relationships with people who have a relationship with God. I cannot stress how important that is, because we've been around and we've been around some folks and listened to them and really liked them and admired them. And truth be told, they did not have a relationship with God. They wanted God to have a relationship with them. Mm-hmm. They were too high and mighty to really do His will and His work. They had their own agendas. And we were like, what? You know, so, you know, we learned from that to be very discerning, to be very careful, guard your heart, mm-hmm. You know, and, you know, God at this point in our lives has us like watchmen on the tower, just watching. Mm-hmm. And when we see somebody hurting, we're like eagles. We swoop in and surround them, because that's what He did for us. Eagle or a duck.
He's like, I want to be an eagle, but I don't want to be no duck.
Yeah.
And that's right, Leslie. We swoop just like eagles.
Yeah. We're like mother hens, you know. Yeah. We see people, we let them know that we see. We don't even have to say anything. We just let them know that we see them.
And let us put this out here on the air and be real clear. When we speak, we do not speak death. When we speak, we do not co-sign. When that means we do not say, oh, well, that person shouldn't have did that to you, or that person. No, when we speak, we come from a prayer place of love. And how did that make you feel? Because it ain't about the person, it's about you.
Yeah.
And if you don't learn how to deal with the issue, because the issue is not the person, the issue is your issue, you will not last in this walk. You know, and then for me, I think it's very important that I say that for me, because a lot of people say, oh, I was supported and I gave them spiritual guidance and yada yada yada. I'm not giving you no spiritual guidance. You're coming, you asking me for help. I'm gonna give you what God told me to give you. And basically He said to love on you, and the other part of it is what I've been skilled to do. Find out what the issue is. Mm-hmm. What is the root? Where is this trigger coming from? Mm-hmm. And if you don't, that's the work. That's the work that Leslie's been saying for the last 4 years, that we all need to be doing is walking in Christ. You got to do the core work.
Yeah, and don't take things personally. I've been attacked. Venetia's been attacked. And these have been by folks who have been around. And what we learned is it wasn't us. It wasn't us. It was their stuff, and they just projected it on us.
Yeah.
And you know, I always tell Venetia, once you get your emotions caught up in a battle, you've lost.
Yeah.
Because you cannot be objective. You know, you're caught up on your feelings. And yeah, I learned the hard way, just pull back and let God handle it. And even if somebody is like really like trying to jam me, I've learned, you know, God, I don't know why this is happening. You've got a reason. Mm-hmm. This is for a purpose. You can handle it, because I'm going to get kicked out of somewhere if my carnal nature, who's like, what? You going to take that? You going to let them say that to you? And I have to like really ask God to bridle my tongue, you know, tame that temper, you know, help me to show his love and not want to be vengeful and mean-spirited, you know. And I've learned when those feelings come or I feel very uncomfortable around somebody, my spirit is saying, this is not for you. And I go the other way. And I don't have a problem with that because I didn't go to church to make friends. I didn't come into recovery to make friends. I came to both arenas to get my life together and to do God's will and his work. And he places people in my life that help me with those tasks.
I forgot what I was about to say. Oh, my God, it was right there. Oh, this has never happened to me. I'm having
not on the air.
Not on the air. I don't know about, I'm not trying to change the subject, but I'm having some serious senior moments lately. I don't know because I'm about to turn 57.
No,
I don't know, but it's like coming at me every which way it can come. But I think when Leslie was talking, I think the most important thing that I think I know what it was. Don't get mad at the person that walks up in the door and you can see what they have, but they don't know yet.
Mm-hmm.
Don't take that out. That's when you're supposed to love on them and nurture them and guide and help them along the way because, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to help them anyway as long as they're receivable to him, you know. But don't get angry at the person that walked through the door that don't know that all these who they are yet.
What gifts they have.
You know, and you're taking out on them. If you're going to get angry at the creator that created them. That's my thing. That's my thing. And the other thing too. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Do not get caught up with people who come from a religiosity place. Because what Leslie was just talking about a little while ago, that's called religiosity. You want to walk around with people who's full of Christ. Full of love. He comes from a place of love. He has not come from a place of religion. You understand what
I'm
saying?
And he's not jealous.
And he's, you know.
And he's not caught up in traditions.
God is a jealous God. You better take that back.
No, I mean, God is jealous, but he's not showing jealousy as people do.
Oh, no. And he never, ever show favoritism. None of us. He loves us all the same, you know. It's just. There's more to that, but we'll talk about that later on. But because we're still learning a lot about it, too, as well, as we're walking in our walk. But, you know, I think it's just so important that, for me, the connection with me being in recovery and the connection of me walking in Christianity, God knew the plan all along. He knew the plan all along. He knew that both had to become one.
Yep.
I had to go through what I had to go through to become an addict. I had to learn to believe and trust in others. You understand? And walk in what we called in recovery as blind faith. If they can do it, then maybe
so I
can do it. You know, until I get the faith and confidence in my own self. And then I, in turn, become a role model to the next generation that comes up to that comes up behind me. And that's all I'm trying to do is get it right doing this, you know, just walking in a godly way and not ungodly, you know. No, I'm not perfect, and yeah, I got issues, you know, but the good thing about me and Leslie and so many other people that's walking around here, and I said, God be the glory that he opened those doors, is that he allowed people to come to us and touch us and let you see your issues and let you know what your issues are, and this is what you got to deal with. This is where you got to get this stuff from. You got to take that stuff and move it, because I can't come nowhere near you until you remove that poison, you know. And so all we're saying is that just it's so important to first and foremost is to make that relationship with God. And I know I did that when I was in treatment. Well, I did it when I was out there, but it was like Cracker Jack. God, Lord, if you get me out of here, I'll tell you I ain't going to get high no more. I ain't going to get high no more. As soon as he get me out, I'm right back out there doing the same thing in the same place, you know, in the same position all over again, asking for help again, you know. But when I got to treatment, when I was there, finally 9 months. It took 9 months. I had to be in that program 9 months to get it. Then I believed that it wasn't about me. I was powerless. It was all about him. It was all about him. He put all these spiritual women in my life, and he had them break me, strip me, unclothe me, made me naked, and I got rebuilt all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's doing the same thing. Now he's saying, "This, get rid of the feelings. You don't need the feelings now. get the heart off your shoulder now, Vanessa." You know, like Leslie said, you can't personalize everything. And I think for me, the other thing that I'm learning more is when I'm hearing about this one doing this one or this saint's doing that one, I said, we need to pray right now in the name of Jesus. And, we, you know, just stop praying. Mm-hmm. You know, just stop. Prayer works. Prayer works. You may not see it when it's working, mm-hmm. but I'm telling you, prayer works, you know. And so if you get around people and you feel that way, you just go and you get someone that you trust and you know that's walking in Christ and ask them to pray with you, you know. And I'm trying to tell you, you're going to be okay. Look at me and Leslie. We still here, you know. And I'm trying to tell you, Satan real upset with us right now. Mm-hmm. He's throwing everything he got at us. He's trying to destroy our families. But guess what? We ain't going nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
We ain't going nowhere. We had our life with him. He tried to kill us. Lord is letting us live an eternal life. You know, once this flesh is gone, as long as I stay on the right and the narrow gate with the Lord, I'm going to be living eternally. And that's what my game is. And leaving a mm-hmm. legacy behind of pure love for my family and my friends. And even my enemies.
I am just so grateful from where God has brought me from, and you know, and I no longer have to cry out to God in a jackpot. Mm-hmm. I no longer have to cry out to God when I'm scared that I really messed up or that I'm in a situation that I can't control and I need his help to survive it. I know I can talk to him just like I talked to Benicia. You know, I talk to God several times a day. I pray to God every time mm-hmm. I feel something trying to come on me mm-hmm. to take me off the path mm-hmm. that he has preordained. And I pray, you know, and it's simple. You know, I had to learn how to pray because, you know, I thought it had to be this big spiritual rigmarole. And, you know, people taught me, no, you talk to God just the way you're talking to me. You know, and when we first came on the air, I will not forget Brother Santos because he told us on those early broadcasts that we might be the only Bible people see. So I try to keep that up front. I really Amen. Do because I don't want anyone to become discouraged, you know, or disappointed, you know, by me giving in and not being able to follow through on what I say. It's real important. If I say I'm going to do something, I do it. Mm-hmm. The old Leslie, well, you know, oh, I'll do it. I'll be there. And a better deal came along. There I was. So I remember where I came from. I don't forget that. I keep that up front every day. When I see people out on the street, I'm like, thank God that's not me anymore. You know, and I don't get an attitude. If somebody asks me for change, you know, that could be an angel. That could be God himself saying, let me see if she really means what she says. I don't judge them anymore. You know, can you wait till I come out? You know, and if I give what I haven't, loose change in my pocket. But I had to learn that. Someone had to teach me that and tell me that because I just assumed what folks were going to do with the little bit of money that I had. You know, I'm like figuring out what I'm going to do with it. And you got a nerve and you asking me for my little pennies? Oh, no. And, you know, God took all of that away. He's like, no, help my people. You know, so if you're giving somebody change or just a kind word, you don't know how that lifts people up. That brightens somebody's day when you speak to them or you give them a hug. We're huggers. You know, I like to hug people. You know, never mind. I'm not formal. I'm not going to shake your hand. I'm going to give you a hug. I'm going to touch you. I'm going to let you know that I'm not afraid to get close to you. You know, and whatever you need, if I can do it, and that's God's will, you've got it. You know, because we all know what it feels like to walk in someplace for the first time and be scared out of your mind and hope nobody notices that you're kind of frightened and acting like you know what you're doing. You know, so I am really grateful that God continues to work on me, that he continues to give me messages and, you know, and give me those little thumps on the head when I'm, you know, the stinking thinking comes in, or I just want to, like, say, you know what, I can't do this right now. You know, he's like, oh, yes, you can. You know, you ain't stopping. You know, and we always talk about, we don't run anymore. we were runners.
I've been trying.
We had on gold track shoes. We were out.
I still try. I'm not going to lie up in here. I still try to run. He won't let me go. Go on, Leslie.
You know, and so I'm so grateful that I know that he's got me. Even when I can't see it and I can't feel it all the time, I know he's got me, and I don't have to worry about it. And it's, you know, the footprints in the sand, that poem, you know, who do you think carried you? God's carrying us, you know. And like I said, I don't forget where I've come from. I know what I was doing out there in them last days, and I am too old to be trying to do that mess. So I am grateful, you know. If I see people struggling, it's like a little reminder, you know, here it is 25 plus years later and they still doing the same thing. And I'm just grateful that God keeps me, you know. He keeps me sane. He just keeps me humble, and he keeps me being in love with him so that I don't want to leave or go anywhere else. And, you know, like they used to tell us in the early days, when you don't feel like being at a meeting, that's when you need to go. When you don't feel like going to church or worship or Bible study, that's when you need to go.
You better get on the phone and call somebody and talk to somebody and with the quickness. You've been listening to the Recovery Connection with Sister Leslie Wilson and myself, Sister Venetia Simpson, and our engineer, Pastor Bruce Wall, who did an awesome job.
Yes, thank you, Pastor Wall.
And we thank you for listening. We pray that you have a blessed and drama-free weekend, and that everything is full. Oh, my goodness. They got me with the number, you guys. Okay, we have a Recovery Connection 24-hour hotline that we can be reached at 857-258-8691. We are Venetia Simpson on Facebook and Leslie Wilson on Facebook. The Boston RC at AOL.com and vsimpson15 at AOL.com. We love you, we thank you, and God bless you. And have a blessed weekend.
Be safe.
Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. Now I see how you were there for me, and I can say I'm stronger.